A lot of important issues on the table. But first of all, had you been a member of the House or the Senate, how would you have voted for that fiscal relief legislation?
Oh, look, I would have voted for it. You know, I think going over the cliff would have been an economic disaster for the country. It was too much, too quick, too abruptly. And if you look at the cuts that were, you know, in the sequester, they're all in the discretionary items. None of them deal with the things that we really need to slow the rate of growth on, and that's the entitlement programs. And it did generate a little revenue for the company, about $600 billion worth. So I would have voted for it. It was a step in the right direction, but for sure, Wolf, it was a missed opportunity. I've called this the magic moment, you know, where we had a chance for our generation to do something big to put our fiscal house in order, and we absolutely blew it.
In the next few weeks, as you well know, there will be at least three crisis points coming up, raising the nation's debt ceiling, dealing with what's called that sequestration, those automatic spending cuts in domestic spending and national security spending, also a continuing resolution to keep the government operating. How would you deal with those crisis points in order to deal with what you want, which is the big picture, and really getting to the bottom of this whole issue?
For God's sake, I wouldn't wait to the last minute. We've had enough of this brinksmanship, this moving from crisis to crisis. That is a foolish way for any organization, small or large, much less the U.S. government, the largest economy in the world, to run its organization. Here's what we got to do. We have got to make the tough decisions. And we're only about halfway there of the things we have to do. We've got to make sure that we, you know, reform our tax code. We got to broaden the base, simplify the code, get rid of some of this backdoor spending in the tax code. We've got to slow the rate of growth of the entitlement programs, particularly health care. If we don't slow the rate of growth of health care, it will absolutely bankrupt the country. And finally, we got to make Social Security sustainably solvent. These are the big items we have to deal with if we're going to stabilize the debt and get it on a downward path as a percent of GDP. These guys have got to negotiate. They've got to start working together. They've got to put some of this ultra-partisan politics aside and deal with these really big issues.
But you know Washington right now, it's very dysfunctional, despite the last-minute deal on the fiscal cliff, and there was some bipartisanship at the very, very end. But it looks like they only want to deal with what we call small ball. They're not ready to deal with that big picture unless you see something there I'm not seeing.
Oh, look, I can tell you what I see are the things that you said. You know, there is great uncertainty out here in the country. The markets are going to react at some point in time and react severely to the lack of knowledge of what's going to go on, the uncertainty. You know, and we do have the debt ceiling coming up. We do have the budget coming up. You know, we do have this sequester coming up. All of that creates great uncertainty. And what these guys got to do is start acting like grown-ups, and they got to start negotiating, just like I might add we did in the 1990s when President Clinton actually sat down and negotiated with Newt Gingrich and Trent Lott, even when there was ultra-partisanship. People say the partisanship is so much worse today than it was then. Hell, back then, they were trying to impeach the president. I mean, good gosh, we've had partisanship, but you got to put that partisanship aside and work together.
Here's what the president says repeatedly now when it comes to raising that so-called debt ceiling, and it's going to have to be raised by the end of February, early March at the latest. I want to play a little clip. Listen to the president.
If Congress in any way suggests that they're going to tie negotiations to debt ceiling votes and take us to the brink of default once again as part of a budget negotiation, which, by the way, we have never done in our history until we did it last year, I will not play that game.
He says he won't play that game, but Republicans are saying they're only going to raise the debt ceiling if there's an equal amount of spending cuts accompanying the raising of the debt ceiling. He says he's not going to play that game. Will he have any choice?
Look, that's the kind of brinksmanship I'm talking about. We shouldn't negotiate on the full faith and credit of the U.S. government. That is crazy. Why would we want to put our economy through that? But there are lots of things we can negotiate on. We do have the sequester. We do have the end of a continuing resolution. We have lots of things coming up that will force us to make some of these tough decisions.
Here's what Mitch McConnell wrote in an op-ed on Yahoo News, and I'm going to read it to you because he's going after the president. He's the Republican leader in the Senate. Predictably, the president is already claiming that his tax hike on the rich isn't enough. I have news for him. The moment that he and virtually every elected Democrat in Washington signed off on the terms of the current arrangement, it was the last word on taxes. That debate is over. What he's saying is it's now all about spending cuts. No more discussion of taxes for all practical purposes. No more increases in taxes. It's all spending cuts. You agree with Mitch McConnell on that?
I actually don't. I think the primary focus has to be on spending cuts. You know, we have got to slow the rate of growth of health care in particular. We've got to make Social Security sustainably solvent. And we're going to have to do more in the discretionary front, too. So there's lots of work left to be done on the spending side. And we haven't had enough discussions of that to date.
Would you like to be the Treasury Secretary?
No.
Okay, that's a pretty blunt answer because your name, you've seen your name floated out there as a possible successor to Timothy Geithner.
And the reason I say that is, look, I'm 67 years old. I've been gone from home for over a dozen years doing various public service things. And I've come home. I've got 9 grandchildren under 7. And I really want to stay home. So I don't want a full-time job either in the public or the private sector.
One final question. How disappointed were you that the president rejected the Simpson-Bowles recommendations?
Oh, look, I was disappointed at the time, but I came to understand that what he was doing was his goal was to use it as a framework for his discussions that he had with Speaker Boehner back in the, almost 2 years ago now, in his first effort to get a grand bargain. He felt that was the best way to be successful. If he'd been right, he would have proven to be a political genius. Unfortunately, he wasn't. They didn't get a deal done, and so I was very disappointed.
Yeah, I think that was an historic moment to try to do that grand bargain. I know you and Alan Simpson worked hard on it together with the other members of your commission. It was clearly a missed opportunity, certainly with hindsight. At least that's what I think, and I know you agree.
And we're going to keep working on it. This is, you know, our generation, Wolf, yours and mine, we're the ones that created this fiscal mess. I don't care whether you're a Republican or Democrat. Together, we created this mess, and it's our responsibility to clean it up. We can't leave this to the next generation.